I'm going to be talking about hormonal implanting in cattle. I spent a summer with contracted calves, so I did a lot of implanting. So, implants are small pellets that contain a growth stimulant that is slowly released over a period of time. Implants work by increasing circulating levels of somatotropin and an insulin-like growth factor. This causes an increase in the secretion of growth hormones, which increases muscle growth. Many implant products are available for use in nursing calves, stocker calves, and feedlot calves, and they're all designed for each age, sex, and stage of production.
Okay, so remember, I'm your partner. So you guys know somatotropin is another word for growth hormone, and then that comes from the anterior pituitary, and then growth hormone goes to the liver and tells the liver to make insulin-like growth factors, okay? So now, are you going to be telling us what's in the implant exactly?
Yeah.
Okay, take it away.
There's three naturally occurring hormones in implants, so estradiol, progesterone, and testosterone, and then there's two synthetic, Zarinol and Trenbolone acetate. Zarinol and Trenbolone acetate, estradiol, progesterone, and Zarinol are estrogenic, and testosterone and Trenbolone acetate are androgenic. So, estrogenic means it affects the female characteristics, and androgenic means it affects the male characteristics. And this is an implant gun, and here's the implant capsules. So there's each implant, there's like about 10 beads in each of capsules, and the capsules are loaded right here. And then there's a button that you pop them up into this compartment right here, and then there's the needle with the cap on the end, and then you trigger it and it goes into the ear.
So into the ear, I was going to ask you where they, so
yeah.
Kind of like below the skin in the ear.
Yeah, it goes between the skin and the cartilage.
Okay.
So the FDA approves and regulates the use of all growth promoting implants. The only FDA approved location for implanting is the middle third on the back of the ear between the skin and the cartilage. The implant and implant gun should be made by the same manufacturer to make sure the defects stay down. And so how to implant, you need to restrain the animal in a chute or gate to make sure they don't move. Check the needle to make sure it's securely attached to the implant gun. And you have to disinfect the needle between each use. Clean the ear and remove any mud or manure that may be on it. And that reduces the chance for any infection. And then you place the needle in the center one-third of the ear, insert it horizontally between the skin and the cartilage, and you keep it flush to avoid going completely through the ear. And to avoid the pellets from crushing, you slowly withdraw it as you're injecting. The implant should also be slightly movable. If it's placed in the right spot, if you got into the cartilage, it won't move and there's no blood flow, so the implant won't work. And each misplaced implant could cost you $15 to $20. And here's a video of someone implanting.
Super.
They're going to start implanting. We've got a sterile, clean needle that we're going to implant this calf with. If the calf's in the calf table or laying on the ground, you normally implant the ear on top. You don't really think about it a lot of times, but where your ear tag cattle is important if you're going to implant them. You'd like for them to be ear tagged in the rib below where the implant's supposed to go. The implant goes into the middle third of the ear between the top and middle ridge within that ear. Take your implant needle, go under the skin, deliver the implant into that implant site. Once you've implanted the animal, delivered the implant into the ear, you need to always look and make sure you've actually delivered an implant into the ear in a proper location. You can actually see the implant here within that ear. Your needle went in this hole right here. You deposited the implant between the ribs of that ear above the ear tag. You can see the implant under the skin of the ear. You don't want it to go into the cartilage area of the ear, but between the skin and that cartilage of the ear. You take your thumb and close that hole off where your implant needle went in. It'll help keep him from shaking the implant out after he leaves the processing chute, calf table, or gets up off the ground.
So with nursing calves, implanting will increase weaning weight by 15 to 30 pounds. The implants lose their effectiveness after 120 days, so it's more effective to implant twice, once before they're 2 months old and then 4 months after that. Double implanting with Zarinol shows a greater effect than double implanting with estrogen progesterone. Implanting shows greater performance than not implanting, but proper nutrition is also essential to work properly. And stocker calves. So a stocker calf is a calf that you buy in the spring and you sell in the fall. And they're usually used to maintain pastures for someone with a lot of grassland. Implanting stocker calves improves daily gain by 10 to 20%. And the response to the implant is greater in stocker calves than it is in nursing calves. And if stocker calves are kept for more than 140 days, a second implant has a good benefit. And feedlot calves, they're usually implanted at least once during their finishing phase. The response is greater in feedlot calves than in nursing and stocker calves. Most implants that they make are approved for use in feedlot calves. Implanting feedlot calves increases daily gains by 15 to 20%. It can cause their marbling score to decrease by 4%, but their ribeye area could go up by 3 to 4%. It's important to read the label instructions to determine if an implant is safe for heifers. Implanting at the wrong age can have a negative effect on future reproductive performance. So you have to determine if you're going to have a replacement heifer early on, and if you're going to be using her for breeding, you shouldn't implant because it can mess with the reproductive cycle. So if they're going to be used for meat, implant, but if not,
so if you keep them to breed, then don't give them any implants.
Yeah.
That's what you're saying.
Yep. And there are a few side effects that they found with implanting: raised tail heads, udder development, and vaginal and rectal prolapse. Mm.
You're looking for questions. That's good. I got one question. When you implant, after they last, 3 or 4 months?
120
days. Do you go to the other ear?
No, because it's all dissolved by then.
Okay, so it's all
dissolved. It's fully dissolved, and that's what it is.
Okay, so you can just go back to that same ear.
Yep.
Okay, and is there a withdrawal period? Like if you implant somebody, is there a time that you can't sell them for slaughter? Is it 120 days?
No, they're all naturally occurring.
But now two of them aren't. There's two.
But I don't think there's a withdrawal.
Okay, because there's such a small amount. Because usually those implants are made of silastic tubing, and you can make these homemade. We used to make them homemade. You can put any hormone you want in there. We used to do this not for growth, but for other things. And then the hormone slowly, because of the body fluid, then the hormone, that silastic tube, gets wet and moist, and the hormone can leak out of the tubing into the body slowly. So it's not like giving an injection. You want this a slow daily release into the body. So that's how you do that. Any other questions, comments? Okay, because these side effects, those are all estrogen related. See that?